Well, Jesus, your love never gives up, never runs out on us, Lord. And we thank you that we know that you love us, Lord. You proved your love for us on the cross. And Lord, today we need to remind ourselves that you love us, Lord, because in your love you give us hard words. At times you speak hard truths that we need to listen to. And when we listen well, they transform our hearts and souls. So I pray as we regain our study of the Sermon on the Mount, Lord, that you would show us your love by the way that you teach us difficult but beautiful things, so that we may be a people who reflect you to the world around us. I pray for this congregation that they may see your grace. And at the same time, because they see your grace, understand the weight of sin and how it's affected their lives and broken this world. But you are greater than that sin, Lord. So, Lord, I pray that as we approach your word, give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and a deep heart that knows your love and loves you in return. We pray this in your beautiful and holy name. Amen. Today we rejoin our messages in the Sermon on the Mount. We took a little bit of a break and discussed kind of the two questions of what does it mean to be a man and what does it mean to be a woman and what does it mean that we are created in the image of God. And it's kind of interesting because that sermon series fell right into place in the Sermon on the Mount, that the sermon right before it and the sermon right after it deal very, very, very specifically with that sermon series. It was completely unintentional, but it was just one of those serendipitous things that God sometimes does for us, is that he just arranges the timeline such that these messages are hitting in such a way that they reinforce each other. And so today, we jump right back in. And we're jumping into the words of Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount. And one of the things about Jesus' words in the Sermon on the Mount is a lot of times we think of Jesus' words and we think, oh, he's just kind of like this Zen master that says a bunch of light and fluffy things, and you know, and it's just very easy to listen to, and you know, the Zen master Jesus, I can follow him. But then you read something like the Sermon on the Mount and you realize, oh. Truthfully, when I started studying for the Sermon on the Mount and praying, Lord, what is the sermon series you want me to do next? And I was praying over the Sermon on the Mount. And well, God kept saying, you're preaching on the Sermon on the Mount. And I said, Lord, there's some other cool text I could preach on. And he's like, nope, Sermon on the Mount. I said, yes, Lord. And one of the reasons is this section on the law is very, 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 very heavy. And part of my own soul was like, Lord, I don't even know if I can come into your presence with how heavy these words are. And he said, I want you to preach the Sermon on the Mount. And so as we are continuing through it, I want us to remind us that we need to keep thinking about those beatitude, the blessed life that we talked about at the beginning, that blessed are the poor in spirit, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are the meek, hunger and thirst for righteousness, those who are pure in heart, the peacemakers, those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, that there's a dependence on God in following out the laws that we see Jesus articulate here in the Sermon on the Mount. Because what he's doing is he's taking the Ten Commandments, he's taking the law that is very important to the Jewish listeners of the time, and he's cranking them up to 11, showing that apart from a work of God in our lives, we cannot keep the law. And there's a dependence on God. But then as we look at the law, there's a desire to reflect him in the world around us so that we don't want to do those things that bring dishonor and shame to our Heavenly Father. Instead, we want to do what glorifies him and makes much of him to the world around us. So today we are going to dive into the deep end. We're going to be looking at the subject of divorce. And like other teachings in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus does not give us any wiggle room. And this is particularly difficult for a North American congregation because divorce has affected every single one of us in here in one way or another. Just looking at the statistics, divorce is absolutely prevalent in North American culture. And as we look this passage, I want us to first recognize that that this affects us. And then I want us to see how Jesus speaks directly to divorce and remarriage. And it's not an easy topic, but we will see the glory of God being revealed in us and in this message. And before we get to into the text, I want to say there's this beautiful mystery of grace that God gives us in this passage. And in the scriptures as a whole, that even though there are some in here who have gone through divorce and remarriage, there is this mysterious grace that God gives us. He offers grace to those who've been through divorce and remarriage. This doesn't mean that God is happy with it. Instead, it demonstrates that God takes marriage seriously, and he's offered grace to your current marriage. Even though you have divorced and remarried, God can still be honored in your current marriage. Though it's not a free of consequences thing, repentance must take place, but God has given grace in many, many situations. And so when we talk about this, I want to lift the burden just a little bit to say, you know, God is a God of grace, but that doesn't give us freedom to do whatever we want. We have to, if we truly love God as we say we do, we need to live differently as Christians. The danger is that because we have a God of grace, we use God's grace to justify decisions made during times of emotional distress. We have the ability to justify anything. And I implore everyone, not just on this subject, but every subject, not to impose on God's grace. It's very easy for us to say, oh, God will forgive it. I can go do X, Y, or Z. But the truth is, if we think about it, if God's forgiving my sin, that means he forgave it on the cross. So if I'm sinning with the expectation that God will forgive what I've done, that means that what I'm saying is that, oh, I'm going to heap more sin on the cross, and God can handle it. If you truly knew what Jesus did for us on the cross, there would be no desire to add more weight to the grace that he experienced for us by taking the wrath of the Father upon his shoulders. So we need to be careful that we don't look at God's grace and say, oh, I can do whatever I want. No, it means that now we are freed to do what we were created to do. We are created to do what we ought to do. And we are freed to follow our Heavenly Father as we should. And with all that said, God hates divorce. This passage, Jesus doesn't really deal with the exceptions of divorce too much, so we aren't going to be dealing. There's really only two exceptions in the Bible that God gives for divorce, and we won't be dealing with both of them today, just in short, one of them. But really what Jesus is doing in this passage is talking about the consequences of divorce and what does that mean for us. So today we're going to be looking at three questions. The first question is, what is marriage? The second question will be, what is divorce? And the third question will be, what is the consequences of divorce? And so we'll just jump right into Jesus' words here, and we'll go to Matthew chapter 5, back in the Sermon on the Mount, and we will be looking at just verses 31 and 32 today. So starting in verse 31 of Matthew chapter 5. It was also said, whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce. But I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except on the grounds of sexual immorality, makes her commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. So what is marriage? Before we can even talk about divorce, we have to understand what is marriage. Marriage is a covenant where a man and a woman are united together as one flesh for the purposes of glorifying God, subduing creation through reproduction, and the right order of culture in society. A society without good marriage is a society without a healthy foundation. And marriage is the foundation of society. Some philosophers recently have been saying the individual is the foundation of society, but it's marriage is the foundation of society. Families are the foundation of society. Society is made up of human interactions. The first human interaction given to us is the relationship between the man and his wife. We see this in Genesis 2:18, where it says, "Then the Lord God said, 'It is not good that man should be alone. I will make a helper fit for him.'" We have a need for relationships. That we were created with that need for relationships. And God met that first need in the first man, Adam, by creating Eve. And God met that first need for a society in that first marriage. So we must take marriage seriously. The relationship between man and woman in marriage is designed not just to propagate the species, but also bring ordering to society. And we spent the last few weeks looking at what does that mean? What is the roles that each man and each woman has in that propagation of culture and society? And what does it mean that we are created in the image of God, male and female? And together, men and women make up the image of God. And so we saw that. We saw that there was relationships, that there was proper ordering, that men led the family, that women created the culture and transmitted the culture, and that together we build society one family at a time. And we need good, strong marriages to properly order society. When marriages don't thrive, society around us crumbles. The second point is first, well, I'm kind of going backwards in my definition, but first is society that we're looking at. Next we're looking at, marriage was created so that we could be fruitful and multiply. Not just so that we can, because one of the problems with our current secular definitions of marriage is it based on this kind of nebulous notion of love. And it's like, oh, if I love somebody, then I should be able to marry them. And I won't get into that too much today. But it's not just love. It's actually the propagation of the species, the reproduction. It says in the Bible that man and women come together as one flesh. And when man and woman come together in one flesh, the physical result is offspring, thus fulfilling the command to be fruitful and multiply. We see this procreative impulse as explicitly part of the created image of God. We see that in Genesis 1:28, where God said, "God blessed them, and God said to them, 'Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it.'" This is before the fall. So this is very important to note, that be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the heaven, over every living thing that moves on the earth. And we see in Genesis 2:24, "Therefore, man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." In this first marriage specifically, but in marriages in general, we are seeing the image of God being displayed. And it is important for us to understand that, because in this image of God being displayed, two become one, then they become three, where the coming together of two makes a new human being. And thus, we propagate and subdue creation through reproduction. This is something that God sees as wonderful and good. And it's something that Satan absolutely hates. Satan hates the family because it is a proclamation of God's love for us and his creation. Satan, we've talked about a little bit these past 3 weeks that the reason we have so much gender confusion, the reason we have so much divorce and abortion and things like this is because Satan absolutely hates the family. Because it points the world to the beautiful truths of God. And so Satan will go out of his way to destroy families because it brings dishonor to God. Marriage teaches us about God. The God who is one in three persons chose that his first act of revelation is to create two who became one, then produced a third person. It's absolutely mind-blowing that God, perfect Trinity, we have one God in three persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, existing in perfect community. We can say God is love because God is Trinity. Because the Son glorifies the Father. The Father sends the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit magnifies the Son. And there's this perfect, loving community constantly lifting each other up for all eternity. And we get this beautiful unity and community in the Godhead. And what does God do? He says, it pleased him to make us in his image, that we would reflect his image and that we would reflect his community in the way that man and woman become one flesh and then produce offspring through that relationship. And so then you have a metaphor for the community that is in the Trinity. And we have this beautiful image of God revealed in the family. Families are absolutely important to the understanding of who God is. To the founding of society, for the reproduction, but also for understanding who God is. We see God's Trinity in Genesis 1:26, where he says, God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the heaven, over the livestock, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. We see God said, let us make man in our image. We see him speaking in this Trinitarian formation, even in the first couple of pages of the Bible. We see in Ephesians 5 something beautiful as well. In Ephesians 5:25, the Apostle Paul writes this, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, that he may sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word, so that he may present the church to himself in splendor without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, that she might be holy and without blemish. God is using the image of the way that a husband loves his wife to display the way that Jesus loves the church. God uses the image of the way a husband should love his wife as the image of how Jesus loves his church. It's very important for us to understand this, that as the way we, especially us as husbands, as the way we love our wives, we are declaring what we believe Jesus, how Jesus loves his church. And so it's important for us to live as men, live out that love in a humble and a sacrificial way like Jesus did. But in that, there is a proclamation in marriage that we see the way God loves his people. This is both true in the Old Testament and the New Testament. In the Old Testament, there's constant images of how God considers his relationship to his chosen people as a husband to his wife. Throughout the whole of the scriptures, we see this. So it's very important for us to understand that marriage was created so that we could glorify God, we could propagate the species and subdue the earth, and that we would create society and culture through that propagation. So then, now that we've seen that, what is divorce? What does it mean to have a divorce? A divorce is the dissolution of the covenantal union ordained by God that two should become one flesh. It is the division of that one flesh. Divorce is always destructive, and it is the equivalent to death. Because the one flesh that was created by God gets killed. We have a problem in our day and age on divorce. Divorce is too easy in our current culture. Interesting thing is that the debates we're having over a divorce today is actually some of the ones that were happening back during the time of Jesus. During the time of Jesus, people were asking Jesus about divorce. In Matthew chapter 19, verses 1 through 8, Jesus was asked about divorce, and Deuteronomy 24 in the law, it talks about divorce, but Jesus, when he was asked about that passage, Jesus said to them, because of your hardness of heart, Moses allowed you to divorce your wives, but from the beginning it was not so. And I say to you, whoever divorces his wife except for sexual immorality and marries another commits adultery. There were two scholars during the time of Jesus. One was Rabbi Hillel, and the other was Rabbi Shammai. Really interesting fellows. But Rabbi Hillel believed that there's a line in Deuteronomy 24 that says, any indecency, if the husband finds any indecency in his wife, then he may give her a certificate of divorce. And Rabbi Hillel took the kind of the modern day and age notion that if his wife displeases him in any way, he can just get rid of her. There was like a low bar for divorce. It was like whatever he felt like, he could send his wife away. And then there was Rabbi Shammai. On the other hand, he took a very strict interpretation of that. What does that word indecency mean? And he saw that there was very little, if any, exceptions in the scriptures for divorce. And Jesus clearly is siding with Rabbi Shammai in this passage that there is really, in this passage specifically, there's very little exception for divorce. And so it is clear that God hates divorce. And we live in a day and age where we have, they call it no-fault divorce. You don't need really any reason to get a divorce these days. It means it only takes one person to say, you know what? I don't want to be in this marriage anymore. And they can file for divorce. I know too many people who, instead of working on their own discontent in their hearts, have pulled the easy out card in their marriage. The real vows in marriage in America are not for better, for worse, sickness, and in health. In truth, the real marriage vows, as they play out, are more until it gets difficult or till you don't make me happy anymore. Here's the thing is we get this notion of happiness where it's like, well, God wants me to be happy. And the danger in this is that what we define as happiness is not the same thing what God defines as happiness. We want it to be easy. We translate easy to happy. What God wants you to be is holy. He wants you to be sanctified. That is why he sent the Son to die on your behalf. He wants you to be holy. And in holiness, we find deep, true joy and happiness. And sometimes it takes a difficult road to walk. We have to go through difficult things and difficult seasons with difficult people. And God takes us to that destination of holiness, step by step, day by day, through the power of the Holy Spirit. We need to be aware that this no-fault divorce, this easy-out mentality cannot exist in the church. That we, as brothers and sisters in Christ, need to hold each other accountable, especially during those difficult times, that we would work together so that we wouldn't take those easy-out cards, but instead glorify our Father and seek the path of holiness. So over these past 3 weeks, when we took a break from the Sermon on the Mount, we looked at the question of God creating us in his image, male and female. He created us with specific order and specific roles. The wonderful image of God is most felt in marriage. God took man and divided mankind into the two parts, male and female. Then he provided a union where man and woman could be united as one. In marriage, we model the unity of God. When we take lightly the unity of marriage, we do damage to the proclamation that God is one. Especially for us as believers in Christ. When we take lightly the union of marriage, what we are declaring to the world around us is that we do not believe in the image of God. We do not believe in a God who is one. And instead, we are doing damage to that proclamation. A lot of times, and people look at statistics of people who are in the church, and they see that the statistics of people in the church, they often have the same divorce rates as the people around in the world. Though, when you break into those specifics, we can have a debate. But when people see that in the church, the divorce rate is just as high on a surface level as the world around, then they say they don't really believe in a God who is one. Because their proclamation is being damaged by the way they take marriage lightly. So my desire for us as a congregation is that we would take marriage as a beautiful, serious proclamation of the glory of our God who is one. And finally, I want to address this concept here of this notion that he talks about, where he says, if a man divorces, but I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except on the grounds of sexual immorality, makes her commit adultery. And I want to just address this term here, except on the grounds of sexual immorality. The word here, sexual immorality, is translated from the Greek word porneia. And porneia is actually the Greek word we get our word pornography from. And Jesus says, except for porneia, sexual immorality, there is no conditions that you can divorce your spouse. And the interesting thing about this word is he says porneia, he says sexual immorality. He doesn't say except in the case of adultery. He says except in the case of sexual immorality. And he could have said, except in the case of adultery, but he says, except in the case of sexual immorality. And what he's doing here is, I believe, is that he's pointing towards Leviticus 18. And in Leviticus 18, you see the laws governing sexual morality. And the first kind of large section of it is just showing different types of incestuous relationships that are completely prohibited on in the scriptures. And then it also deals with homosexuality, bestiality, and adultery as well in that passage. And This is clearly a moral law that applies to everyone. So there's three types of law. We're going to get into some Old Testament law here. You ready? There's three types of law we see in the Old Testament. There's ceremonial law, and that deals a lot with like the worship that takes place at the temple, like the sacrificing of bulls and goats and sheep and things like that at the temple. And that doesn't apply to us as post-Christ Gentiles especially, but after Christ, the ceremonial law was complete in Jesus Christ. So that doesn't apply to us directly in the way it did. Then there's the national laws. That applies specifically to the people of Israel who lived during that time period that the law was given. And even in those national and ceremonial laws, we see a lot about the revelation of God. And I hope one day we get to go do a sermon series through the laws and we get to learn about, you know, what happens if you don't put a parapet around your house and things like that. Really, really fascinating stuff. What do you do when you get mold on your wall? How do you take care of that? And laws like that, because there's, I believe, really fascinating things that God shows us. But there's the moral law, and the moral law is the universal law. It's the universal law from Adam to the time that Jesus returns and on, where we get to see that it's that law that was written on our hearts when we ate from the garden. We ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That knowledge of good and evil that's written on our hearts, the moral law speaks directly to that. And Leviticus 18 is not ceremonial. It is not national law. It is very clearly moral law, because it says anybody who commits these things, the land will spit them out. And it's in very clear terms. And then in the New Testament, we see Paul referring to these Leviticus 18 moral laws and 1 Corinthians chapter 5, because there's a believer in the Corinthian church who has married his mother-in-law. Or not his mother-in-law, his stepmother. And that's clearly forbidden in Leviticus 18. And Paul's like, cut that nonsense out. This isn't how we live as Christians. And so when Jesus is referring to accepting the case of sexual immorality, I believe he's pointing to this Leviticus 18 law and saying when there is relationships that do not honor God, they need to be addressed. And that, I think, is a very, when you actually look at it, a very limited exception. And here's the interesting part about this, is that this passage comes directly after the conversation on lust. If you remember the week before we went into our three-part series, we had a message on lust. And that Jesus says, if you look at a woman lustfully in your heart, you've already committed adultery with her. And I don't think it's any mistake that Jesus starts there and then go straight to divorce. Because I believe what he is doing is we need to have humility when we approach this topic. Because even in the cases of adultery, we need to be aware of the adultery in our own hearts. That we were saved by grace as well. And that we, you know, we might not have physically committed those acts, but we have spiritually committed those acts in our heart. So that as we approach this, it's, and we see this, except on the grounds of sexual immorality, it's like, oh, I need to be careful where I step here, because even in my own heart, I may have committed that as well. So that you have significantly more grace for your spouse as you walk through these difficult times. We had friends when we were in Fort Carson, Colorado. The husband deployed, and during his deployment, he ended up committing adultery. And he came back. He was ready to leave his wife, and by the grace of God, something got a hold of his heart. I don't know the specifics of it, but he was ended up being reconciled to his wife. And even today, they're still married to this day because they were able to work through that difficult, 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 difficult season. And so the reason I say this is that even in the cases where adultery has happened, there is a road to healing and grace and redemption that can glorify God. And that even adultery doesn't mean that we have to get a divorce. That it is much more glorifying to God to find grace and reconciliation in the midst of some of the most broken moments of our life. And we can glorify God in deep and profound ways. So this brings us to our third question. What does divorce cause? The first thing that divorce causes is it causes dishonor to God. The covenant of marriage is ordained by God. It is God who creates and ordains the institute of marriage. So when I stand before a husband and wife and I pronounce you man and wife, you may kiss your bride, and the husband kisses his bride and everybody rejoices, it is not me that creates that marriage between that man and that his wife. It is God who ordains that marriage. I am merely the proclaimer of that marriage. Even when people go to the justice of the peace and just have a quick ceremony at there at the desk of the justice of the peace, it is not that justice of the peace that creates and ordains that marriage. It is God. For those people who go to Vegas and it's Elvis performing the ceremony, Elvis doesn't create the marriage. It's God. And we see in Matthew 19, verse 6, and Jesus speaking again, he says, "So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let no man separate." It is a union called and ordained by God. And divorce is dissolving that union, that covenant that God has made, God has ordained, God has declared holy and good. And so it dishonors God when we dissolve that union. Next, it causes trauma. There is always painful trauma in divorce. If two become one flesh, then divorce is like having an amputation. My sister-in-law, before, when she was battling cancer, she lost her leg. And we saw firsthand the trauma that comes when losing a limb. The difficulty of learning how to walk again, the learning how to stand, learning how to adjust your leg so it doesn't chafe in the new leg, in the prosthetic leg, and various things like that, and the trauma of that ran really deep. Or I think about my father. My father lost his heart. He had a heart transplant in 2016, where his old heart died, and somebody else gave their life so that he could have a new heart. The trauma in getting that new heart, first off, somebody had to lose their life, but second off, he had spent 90 days laying in a hospital bed, so he had to learn how to walk again. He had to build up the muscle strength to even be able to get to the place where he could learn how to walk again. For the rest of his life, there were, you know, when he needed to, you know, when you exercise and your heart rate goes up, his heart rate would take forever to get up to speed because it was a borrowed heart. And even in that, there's that realization that for him to have that heart, somebody else had to have passed away. And there was trauma in losing his heart. He often joked, he said, "Because I have a new heart, does that mean I have to ask Jesus into this one as well?" But he figured he was okay because the person who donated their heart was a Christian as well. And so he was, they're celebrating together in heaven to this day, I believe. But when we divorce, we are amputating a part of our soul. We are doing damage and trauma to ourselves, to our spouse, and if we have kids, to our children. Especially if we have kids to our children. And we need to be aware of that. I had a friend who said to me, we're getting a divorce because I don't want my kid, it's bad for my kids to see me unhappy. And I looked at him, I said, no, it's much worse for you to get a divorce, trust me. Your kids long for you to be together with your wife and for you to work it out. To soften that hard head of yours and work through what you're going through. That is much better for your children than getting a divorce. The third thing we see that divorce causes, and specifically and explicitly in this Matthew 5 passage, is that Jesus clearly states that the end result of divorce and remarriage is adultery. First thing I want to note is in both instances of divorce and remarriage, Jesus outlines here, the man bears the responsibility for this. It's really, as we mentioned before in the, when we were talking about what does it mean to be a man, men were called to be leaders of their family. And so there is that is put on the shoulders of men, that they are responsible in this passage. That it says, if he sends his wife away, then he is causing his wife to commit adultery. Or if he marries a divorced woman, he is committing adultery with that woman. And so we need to be aware, men, we need to make that extra work to work through the difficult things in our marriage. We need to humble our hearts and seek reconciliation the way Christ demonstrated, because it is that important. And we need to be aware, especially young men, is that in today's age, especially young men who haven't married yet, as you are finding your spouse, that with no-fault divorce, there is a danger in this. That the statistics show that with no-fault divorce, it is more often the plurality of divorces are initiated by the wife. And so we live in this really broken age, but I believe, men, that does not absolve us of the responsibility that God put on our shoulders. And we need to be aware of that and step into that. But for young men, it's very important and young women as well, specifically young men and young women, that as you are looking for your spouse, that you are not unequally yoked. I believe that the statistics show that the more that you share your values, the more that you seek Christ together, the lower and lower and lower and lower the chances of divorce go down. The more that you seek to grow your love of Jesus together, and specifically in gathering in the body of Christ, the lower and lower and lower your chances of divorce go. So it's very, very important that as you are seeking your spouse, you seek someone who loves Jesus with all of their heart. Young men and young women, it's important that you look for a man or a woman who loves Jesus more than you. Because when they love Jesus more than you, they will listen to the Holy Spirit and they will be pursuing holiness in their marriage with you. So it's very, very important that we are not unequally yoked, because it will, in this no-fault, easy divorce era that we live in, it helps prevent that from happening. But that's another sermon that I just snuck in for the heck of it, because I love you all. So divorce and remarriage always creates adultery. And here it must be noted again that to remarry after divorce requires adultery. There is a mystery in the scriptures here that even though adultery was committed to consummate the new marriage is still binding. That is the mystery of the scriptures. And we see it very clearly in Deuteronomy 24, but we also see it, I believe, here in the New Testament as well. That even though the new marriage is consummated through an adulterous moment, the marriage is still binding. For many, this means that the divorce happened long ago and long before they became a Christian. And so that reconciliation to their spouse was not even possible. So the question then becomes, you know, I can't reconcile to my old spouse, and I've married into this new relationship. What hope do I have? Does that mean that I'm always living in sin? You know, is there hope for me now at this point? What do I do? And I think in these moments, scriptures clearly offer grace. That's the beautiful part about the scriptures, is they clearly offer grace. For the person who is divorced and remarried, forgiveness and repentance is possible. So the question then is what does it look like to repent? For the person now longing to live in this new marriage in a God-honoring way. So what does repentance look like for that person? First, one must recognize the sin and damage caused by that first divorce. That's very important. Even if by all metrics, you're the one who was the wounded party, the party that you know, tried everything, didn't want the divorce, and still the divorce happened. In that moment, there's still things that there's prides and there's hurts and there's things that we need to confess and heal from, and there's pieces that we played, even if they're like this small, that we need to be aware of and we need to confess and we need to seek healing in that. So we need to, not just the sin, but the hurts and the wounds need to be addressed and cleaned out. So the second thing we have to do is we have to confess those sins, those wounds, those hurts. We have to confess them to God. We have to address the parts, be they big or be they small, of what we played in that role. And then for the wounds and the hurts, we need to confess them as well. And bring them to the light so that the Holy Spirit can heal them and bring reconciliation to them and make you whole once again. And the third thing that needs to happen is you need to make a commitment to love and cherish your new spouse. That in this new marriage, there needs to be a commitment to love and cherish your new spouse. That this new marriage is a marriage and it is ordained by God, and now you are one with this new person. So you need to commit to loving them because you are declaring with that marriage that God is one. And so you need to cherish your new spouse as Christ cherished the church. Whereas the church longs for her husband, Christ. So there is grace, there is forgiveness, there is reconciliation, there is God glorifying truths and realities when divorce and remarriage has happened. And we should celebrate those reconciliations. We should celebrate those grace-filled moments, those grace-filled marriages. And we should glorify God because of it. We shouldn't use that grace that God, that mysterious grace that God gives us as an excuse to then discard difficult relationships, but instead it should make us want to work on those relationships even more. There is grace in divorce and remarriage, but it does not honor God, and our deepest desire should be for the glory of God. To kind of bring this all to a close, the key here is we need to have humility when approaching subjects like this, especially here in the Sermon on the Mount, because Jesus is trying to humble us all, I believe, is that we need to have humility in passages like this. Because it's very easy in our sinful nature to be like, oh yeah, I'm not like one of those, or at least I'm not like that anymore, or, you know, and we start to categorize ourselves, and the only category we need is sinner saved by grace, or sinner in need of grace. Those are the only two categories we really have. And as we look at the scriptures, we see time and again God referring to his people as a spouse. And in the Old Testament, we see in Hosea, the prophetic book of Hosea, God told Hosea to take a prostitute for his wife. So Hosea married Gomer, and Gomer committed adultery. She eventually sold herself into slavery. And God told Hosea to go buy her back, to make her his wife once again. And in doing this, in using Hosea's just difficult and broken family situation, he showed the people of Israel and his chosen people and us today as the church, he showed us how much he cares for his bride, his chosen people. That even though the people, God's chosen people of Israel at that time, committed such heinous adultery, They were sacrificing pigs in the temple. That you can't get worse than that. Well, they were doing worse than that. They were actually sacrificing children in the Valley of Hinnom. And God fought to get them back. God paid the price of the adultery and slavery of the people of Israel in such a way that we got to partake in that promise that was given to Israel. That we as Christians, in the cross of Jesus Christ, when he paid the ultimate price for our spiritual adultery, we got to call upon him and be brought into that promise that was given to the chosen people of Israel. And make no mistake, this isn't something that just happened in the Old Testament. The church in this day and age struggles with adultery, spiritual adultery. It's very easy for us to have our hearts turned away from the glory of Christ, turned away from seeking to adore our Heavenly Father, to things like carpet colors and, you know, power struggles and, you know, did they wear the KM95 or the surgical mask, or was their handmade, or did they wear one at all? And we start worshiping political figures as opposed to worshiping God. And we put our preferred political candidate on a throne that's just a little bit around the throne of God. So that the one we like is, you know, we have my shrine to Jesus, and then I have my shrine to my favorite candidate here. And then the one over here, the one I don't like, he's Satan. Unless it's this one, then this one's Satan. And we begin to worship things that are not God. They can even be good things. We can begin to worship the music that we sing more than the music, than more than the one that the music is trying to direct us towards. We prefer our particular brand of music over the fact that that music is trying to point us towards a heavenly Father, that Christ is returning for his bride. And so the church clearly struggles with adultery, spiritually speaking, to this day. And so that when we approach a subject like this, when we approach the topic of divorce and remarriage, we need to have broken, humble hearts, because we know that we are not spiritually, free from the effects of these realities. And we need to turn our eyes constantly, constantly, constantly to our Lord and Savior. And we need to turn our eyes constantly, constantly, constantly to Jesus. We need to constantly, constantly be rooting out those adulteries and those lusts of the heart that lead us away from Jesus, lead us away from our spouse, lead us away from those marriages that God has created in his image. And we need to turn our hearts and our minds and our families towards Jesus. It's so very important that we have humility to see the cost of grace and that we long for our grace-filled, loving Savior. Let's pray. Jesus, I thank you that you are good. Lord, that for the people in this congregation who have experienced divorce and remarriage, Lord, your grace is evident in their lives. And I pray that you would work in our hearts, that we would have humble, broken humility, that we would long to reflect you in the way that we love our spouses and the way we work through hard times, and that we would do it for your glory so that we would not be the ones proclaiming that you are divided. So, Lord, I thank you for this text today. I pray that through its study, our hearts would be transformed and that we would be made into your image and likeness more and more day by day as we await your return. I pray this in your beautiful and holy name. Amen. You're the truth, you're the life, you're the way. Heaven knows that I won't be the same.